Om Sai Ram, we welcome you with the next part of Chapter 5 from your Sociology PUC 2 book, Changes and Development of Villages and Urbanization in India. In today's part, we are going to discuss problems of Indian villages. But before we go on, let's discuss the answer to the questions that we asked you the last time. Why are the village studies important? You have to give those 5 or 6 points. That village studies are important because they work as an antidote to book review, and they can expose the real reasons for the creating a change or welcoming a change in the village. And if there is any literary bias, that means books are saying something and in reality there is something else. That only a field study only can tell you. And the findings of these field studies can be recorded for later evaluation. And the development of analytical categories and important for these studies are important for social reformation, so that social reformation will take place due to proper policies that can be made with the help of these village studies. Write the names of the authors. Second question, Rural Sociology in India, A.R. Desai, B. The Remembered Village, M.N. Srinivas. Who gave the following concepts? Sanskritization and Westernization was given by M.N. Srinivas. Culinization was given by N. Prasad. Desanskritization, Majumdar. Universalization and parochialization, Mackim Marriott. Great Tradition and Little Tradition by Robert Redfield. So let's take on the today's topic, which is problems of Indian villages. So this is a very long chapter. So I have subdivided put today's part into two parts because it was very long and complicated for you. So I have made it even smaller. So the total parts will now increase. So let's discuss the problems of Indian villages. All the problems that we come across of Indian villages can be categorized in these two categories. They can be called a social problem and they can be termed as economic and agricultural problems. So let's see what are they. So in social problems, Indian villages are marked with illiteracy, poverty, and health problems. These are the basic three topmost social problems. Illiteracy, we know that most of the population in Indian villages is illiterate. Why? Because lack of educational centers there. And even if the centers are there, they are not proper educational centers. They are not proper because of lack of infrastructure. What is infrastructure? In order to create a particular institution, you do require certain things to run it. So, for example, in case of educational institution, you require a proper building, which is not there. You require libraries, reading rooms, sports grounds, drinking water, sanitation, transport and communication facilities. All these things are not there in rural areas. Communication facilities, which is nowadays is very much dependent on information from internet and other technological devices, which obviously is not there in the rural areas, and because of which you have high dropout rate also. That is, children drop out from the school and they don't become literate or educated. Second point is rural poverty. So World Bank studied the causes for rural poverty in India. And this was done in the 7 districts of Rajasthan. Rajasthan is one of the most backward states in the sense of, in terms of economic advancement. So this was chosen. And what their findings was, why are they poor, the Indian rural areas? First thing that they said was, there is anti-poverty programs are not implemented properly. So either they are not well researched, or even if they are well researched, the proper grants are not given. Even the grants are given, there is corruption. The grants are not reaching to the grassroots level where development should take place. Somewhere there is some kind of discrepancy between the policies and the implementation of these policies. That's why these anti-poverty programs generally remain a flop with these village problems and poverty. So low percentage of population engaged in non-agricultural pursuits. Very few people engage themselves in any other activities other than agriculture. And agriculture is not very advanced agriculture. So that's why they are very poor. Because a study also showed that the people who worked in other areas, in other professions, were economically better off than the agriculturalist. Because the agriculture is also dependent on the traditional methods of cultivation, of irrigation. They are depending on the rainfall. They are depending on the traditional methods. So they are going backwards. They are not able to gain that kind of productivity which a farmer in a developed country or a Western developed country would be achieving, because of these reasons: the traditional methods of cultivation and non-availability of irrigational facilities. Non-availability of electricity also is there. So even if you have some modern equipments with you, for example some modern tractor and all, still you don't have proper electricity to run it. So that also will not work for you. Then you have poor quality of livestock. What is livestock? It is about the animals that are reared in village homes for their products. For example, cows for their milk, cows or buffaloes or goats, they are reared for their milk. So their quality is also very poor. They are generally very undernourished. So they don't give good yield. Then there are imperfect and exploited credit markets, communication facilities and markets. So the credit facilities are also very, very imperfect, because of which the farmers are not able to take proper loans, and even if they do, they are not able to repay it. And the communication facilities are also not up to the mark, and they are not able to use the modern communication facilities, and they don't get to know what is going on in the country as well as in the other side of the world regarding their profession, that is agriculture, because of the low level of education. Then there is absence of dynamic community leadership. So community leadership is generally having their own vested interests, so they do not look into the actual development reasons or issues of the village community. And they have the failure to seek women's cooperation in developmental activities. So World Bank also found that women as a part of the population always lagged behind in these kind of developmental activities. They were rather confined to their homes and those activities only that they were doing. They were not doing any active developmental activities for the village or for the country. And there was very least association of women with the planned programs. Nowadays there are many, but again this is an area of research. How many of such programs are reaching the women, and how many women are really getting benefited out of those. Then there are always inter-caste conflicts and rivalries. So where will you think of the development of the village when you have no unity within you? So that is also one of the reasons for underdevelopment and poverty. Then spending a large percentage of annual earnings on social ceremonies like festivals, marriage, death, feast, etc. This is actually a very big social problem in Indian villages. Their people think in very traditional ways where they don't mind borrowing a good amount of money even if they do not have any repayment capacity. And then they get into the debt trap. They are not able to return the debt that they have taken for such ceremonies, and they are unwilling to discard these kind of expensive customs and traditions. So here comes the third social problem, which is health problem. So you see, in the rural areas there is a lack of skilled medical and paramedical staff as well as equipped medical centers. So these basic facilities are also not present in many of these villages, rather most of these villages. So they have to run to the town, nearby town or some cities, and they had to pay a heavy amount of fees to undertake any kind of medical treatment. Again, there are some schemes by the government, but that are also not reaching to these very, very poor people. Then fertility and birth rate as well as death rates are also very high. So as a result of lack of skilled medical and paramedical staff, fertility is high, birth rate is also high, but the death rates are also very high. So infant mortality and maternal mortality are also pretty high because of lack of proper care. So anyways, but recent studies are a bit progressive in this area, and there is some improvement in these health facilities which are now improving the things on this front. So malnutrition, sporadic outbreaks of epidemics like cholera, malaria, plague, dengue and other communicable diseases are quite common in the village area. The dwellings are unsanitary. That means where these people live, this is generally not very clean. So that also gives rise to health issues and diseases. More than that, alcohol and nicotine drug addiction worsens the state of health condition. So these farmers or these rural people are generally poor. Still, they have, most of them have these kind of vices of using alcohol and nicotine drugs, which worsens their state of health. Then there is a pesticide which is used for, it's a chemical pesticide known as endosulfan, and it causes so much health hazard in rural areas that more than 5,000 people are affected by it in Uttara Kannada district alone. At the same time, soil has been degraded, rendering it infertile due to excessive use of chemicals and fertilizers, and it has affected not only the yield but also the health of the agriculturalists. So these kind of pesticides or these kind of fertilizers, when they are used by these people, not only that it affects these people health wise, it also degenerates the soil's capacity to produce a good yield. So with that, we finished the social problems. Now we are coming to economic and agricultural problems, which are so many in numbers and major for these rural people. So there are 10 problems that are discussed here. Disparity between urban and rural. Then discriminatory policy of the state government, where generally the farmers and the agricultural section remains neglected. Then you have vulnerability of agricultural sector. Because of proper strict policies for them, the agricultural sector is very, very vulnerable, that is open for damage or losses. Then there is increased cost of cultivation and environmental degradation. So these are also the big problems for the Indian farmer. Withdrawal of welfare programs by government. So welfare programs were initiated but were withdrawal. As the government changed, the programs also changed. So they hardly benefit the farmers. Globalization, competition, exploitation by big corporates. So agriculture at times becomes a very big industry also. But it is for the other kind of farmers who are very educated and rich, and they can afford better seeds, better manure to get better yields, and they will grow cash crops or commercial crops and not the traditional crops. So there is a strict competition also. So who is at loss? The small farmers are at loss. Then non-availability of loans, because these loans by completely these institutional organizations, that is governmental organizations, they are such a tedious task, such a complicated task to get these loans, that an uneducated farmer is not able to avail of them. Then failure of cooperative sector, that there are many cooperatives that are set up in the villages, but they are also not able to help the farmers very much because of lack of money. And they also cannot generate more money because of lack of repayment ability. Then groundwater dependence. They all depend in the groundwater, because as we had discussed, irrigation facilities are very, very traditional, and they all depend on the rainfall and groundwater. So they are completely dependent on that, and a time comes when the groundwater also depletes. Then they don't have much to depend on, and their agriculture in activity, what they were doing, comes to a standstill. Then there is a rise in drought prone areas. Obviously, when you are taking so much of groundwater, then a time will come that the area will face drought. So these are some points, and I've just given you an introduction to each of these points. So let's see, take up these points one by one. First is disparity. Disparity meaning contrast. So one side it is different, another side it is very different. So this kind of disparity is seen in contemporary India, which depends on region and class. So the ones who are high class people, they get more and more, and those who are already low, they again don't get much from the country's economy or the development. The Nobel Prize winning economist Amartya Sen worries that as these inequalities intensify, one half of India will come to look like California, that is a very progressive city of America, and the other half like sub-Saharan Africa, which is a very underdeveloped nation. So India will be a mixture of both because of this disparity, that the rich are becoming richer and the poor are becoming poorer. Already in India, prosperity coexists with misery and technological sophistication with human degradation. You can think of those big tall buildings, and just beside them is a large expanse of the slums. So this is what disparity is, and this is a very typical scene in India. Then there are discriminatory policies. Discrimination, you already know the meaning of it. The farmers as a group today feel to be let down by the policies of the state that puts them relatively in a disadvantageous position. So the farmers are generally at a disadvantageous position where they feel that the state has discriminated against them. The state is not thinking much about the poor farmers, rather it is thinking more about the other kind of institutions but not about the agriculture. So hardly any grant is given to these areas. Then policies are sufficiently lopsided in widening the gap between the net income of farmers and agricultural laborers on one hand, and the remaining professionals on the other. So generally what we will see that the policies are lopsided, meaning policies are deficient, where it widens the gap. The gap becomes more and more between the net income of the farmers and agricultural laborers on one hand and the remaining professionals on the other hand. So if you see the other professionals like doctors, lawyers, teachers, they earn much more than a farmer. So this is what they mean by discriminatory policies. During the decade of 1990s, the situation got worsened by policy failure due to factors like successive droughts. So many droughts came in 1990s and the prices did not pick up even in the event of low production. Production was low. That means things were less, supply was less, still the prices were not high. And the economic reforms did not amply touch the agricultural sector. So there were reforms and economic reforms also. But the agricultural sector, especially the one being run by the poor farmers, it remained kind of untouched by these economic reform policies. Third point, vulnerability of agricultural sector. That the agricultural sector operates under large constraints. What are these constraints? That is, they have to work under a lot of pressure. What are these pressures? That state policies dictate prices, the factors of production of agriculture. For example, electricity, water, fertilizers, pesticides, and minimum wages. So the price is set by the state. So the farmer has to just take the price that is set by the state. It may be very low and it may be very high in case of cost of production. So on one side, the cost of production is increasing for the agriculturalist. On the other side, the income that is being generated by the agricultural produce is very, very low. And it is not in their hands to fix the price. It has already been fixed by the state government. So they cannot compensate for the losses also. The credit market operations are largely dictated by credit policy of the Reserve Bank. So the Reserve Bank is the main central bank of India, which controls the issues and supplies of Indian rupees. It is a basic and chief regulator of entire banking system in India. And it plays an important role in formulating developmental policies of India. So Reserve Bank is a very, very important bank which plays important role in formulating policies, credit policies. Who will get the credit? How will they get the credit? So all this will be formulated by the Reserve Bank. And as a result of that, there are difficulties in access to the credit. Difficulties in accessing institutional credit compel the farmers to approach money lenders and a new emerging institution, the input dealer. So what is happening here is because of the complication of these credit policies or how to avail of these credit policies, it is very complicated and you have to have some amount of capital to show to return these money back. Otherwise, the bank will not give you loan. Even if they give you loan, they will not give you very small amount of loan. They'll give you big amount of loan. These kind of institutional credit centers. Institutional credit centers meaning organized credit centers such as Reserve Bank and other associated banks. So the poor farmer and uneducated farmer cannot go to these banks and avail of the credit facilities. So it compels the farmer to approach money lenders. So they go to private money lenders who charge a very big amount in the name of interest. And they calculate their own interest, which the farmer cannot even cross-check whether the interest calculation is correct or are they being exploited by these private money lenders. So with that, there is a new emerging institution of input dealer has come. There are courses that are being run by various institutions in this area of input dealer. Who is an input dealer? He is a link between the information, banking information, as well as the formalities and the other requirements that are required by these banks to fulfill those on behalf of the farmer. So there are a link between the bank and the farmer and credit facilities and credit policies. Then there are weather uncertainties. So despite of having all these problems also, that they cannot avail of loan, they cannot set the price of their product. Now the third problem is whatever they are doing, that is also very much dependent on weather conditions. If the weather is not good, they do not have much to plant or produce. Unavailability of irrigation water and inputs like fertilizers and pesticides. So they are also most of the time unavailable. Then product market imperfections and price fluctuations. So the market also is imperfect. So sometimes the prices are high, sometimes they are low, and price also they fluctuate. This is the meaning of price fluctuations. And the process of globalization has intensified their concerns. So what is this process of globalization? That now everything is available from all around the world. So there are some rich farmers who can make use of better seeds, better cultivation facilities. They give a very big challenge to the poor farmer. What will the poor farmer do now? Because the quality of his produce will not be able to compete with the quality of the globalized produce by the rich farmer. So this also intensifies or increases their problems. So basically it is the poverty of an uneducation, lack of education of the Indian farmer, which is putting him in so many other concerns or problems. Then prominence of trade and the resulting commercialization process in the agricultural sector. So agricultural sector, as we have just told you, due to the process of globalization, is becoming very much commercialized. So now cash crops are grown by the rich farmers as compared to the subsistence agriculture, that is what kind of agriculture, only what is required for my consumption and, you know, little bit of saving. So they do not produce cash crops, they produce what is required in the family, so, and little bit of sale. So that is not yielding them enough money to look after their families as compared to the farmers who are able to sell the cash crops. So they are earning profits. Now the fourth point is increase in cost of cultivation and environmental degradation. So not only that they are not able to earn much from their agricultural produce, not only that they are not getting enough credit facilities, not only that they are being exploited money-wise by the money lenders, not only that they are uneducated, but also there are problems of increasing cost of cultivation. The cost of cultivation is also increasing, and there is, on the other hand, environmental degradation also is there. Environmental degradation because of, as we had discussed, that they are using very harmful pesticides, very heavy chemicals, which is degrading the condition or the nutrients in the soil. So the soil will not be able to produce good quality crop because the soil has become poor now. And not only this, there are significant increase in the input prices or technology. Input meaning the agricultural devices that are used or the agricultural labor that is required to produce their crops. So all these have become more expensive for the farmer. Technology has become more expensive. On one side, the farmer is becoming poorer and poorer and poorer. On the other side, the cost is going up, up, up and up. So the farmers also face high transaction costs. So what is a transaction cost? Transaction cost is something which is the expense which is incurred while buying or selling a good or a service. So if you are doing agriculture practices, so what are your cost? What is your cost of production? You will be buying seeds, you will be buying manure, you will be buying some, you will be giving money to agricultural labors also, because you can't undertake the entire agricultural activity on your own. So all that will come under your cost of production. How will you pay that much when you are not even earning enough, and when your crop is so much dependent on the weather conditions, on the rainfall? Someday it will rain so much that it will be flood, other day it will not rain at all. So in both the cases, your crop will completely be spoiled. So how can they depend on agriculture in this condition? They are declining water tables. So what are water tables? Basically they are talking about groundwater. And groundwater has been used excessively because they have no other resource for irrigation facilities. So definitely their water tables are coming down. That means the earth itself cannot give them much water now. Then loss of agricultural biodiversity. So they cannot make use of the varied opportunities that the agriculture produce can give them. They cannot make use of that. So that is also this kind of agricultural biodiversity is also one of the factors. So agricultural biodiversity is basically a broad term that includes all components of biological diversity of relevance to food and agriculture. So they constitute the agricultural ecosystem. So if you have a rich agricultural ecosystem, it will come back to the agricultural productivity and the yield will increase. But because of not being able to help this agricultural biodiversity, for example, the declining water tables, the plants, the animals, everything is of a poor quality. So that will be the reason and the result also of the loss of agricultural biodiversity. So it will impact the production. Then plant diseases and pests challenge to the pursuit of agriculture. So other than this, there are plant diseases also. Even if the farmer has produced a good crop, the plants are many a times get infected by some kind of diseases. So they are not fit to be sold in the market. And there are pests also. So even if there is pests, meaning rats and all, even if you have produced something, they will go and finish it or they will contaminate it. So it is not fit for consumption or for resale. Fifth point is the deliberate withdrawal of the welfare programs by the state. So the deliberate withdrawal of the state from its welfare role for farmers and agricultural labors has contributed to the accentuation of the agrarian crisis. So it has been termed as deliberate withdrawal. So that means it is a well thought of withdrawal of the state. Well thought of non-compliance or not thinking of the state about the welfare of the farmers. So the capitalist agriculture in India could thrive because of the proactive role of the state in providing infrastructure, irrigation and credit through institutional agencies. So basically, who was flourishing in Indian agriculture? The capitalist agriculture of India. What was the capitalist agriculture? Those who were making the cash crops, those who were producing the cash crops, and they were sending it to the world markets. They were the rich farmers. They only get the benefits from the government, and they got the proper infrastructure, irrigation and credit also through institutional agencies, not the poor farmer. Gradual reduction of the state investment brought decline in agricultural productivity. So the state government was investing more for the agriculturalist capitalist rather than for investing in the policies to improve the condition of a poor farmer. Partial withdrawal of subsidy given to farmers or agriculture. So adding to their already existing miseries, there was a partial withdrawal of subsidy. What is subsidy? Subsidy is concession that generally these people get, poor farmer will get on cost of production. So that subsidy was also withdrawn by the government, state government. Free power withdrawal from agriculture. Earlier the power that was given to them was free. Now some tariff or charges were levied on these power facilities also. And the farmer has not even enough to eat. Where will they give the money for these kind of expenditure? Then there was drastic increase in power tariff. So whatever electricity or water supply, they have to pay the money for that. So there was a high increase in the tariff or the tax on these facilities, which the poor farmer was unable to give. And the sixth point is globalization, resultant competition and exploitation by big corporates. So the state of farmer society that surfaced in India was naturally associated with the following challenges. So many farmers committed suicides, which was a very, very big concern. And this was the time when the entire nation turned around and took a note of what was happening to the poor farmers. So the first time they understood the problems that the poor farmer was facing. And what were those farmers? What was those problems? Advent of the World Trade Organization, WTO, leading to agrarian crisis. So when the WTO came into the picture, they advocated genetically modified GM variety seeds, because these seeds will give you very high yield and good quality yield, but they are chemically laden, but they can produce your yield very fast. So the price collapsed and spurious seeds. So the price was collapsed because now there was all the price and the market was captured by the rich agriculturists who could buy these genetically modified variety. And who had to pay the cost? The poor farmer. Now he was not at all in the competition because the prices collapsed. And the World Trade Organization model of agriculture, or McKinsey model of development, it created spaces for industry-driven agriculture, leading to agribusiness, including information technology. So they gave spaces to very high quality agricultural practices, which were like businesses, profit-oriented. And they included information technology. But this was meant for very highly educated, high-class farmers, those who can be termed as capitalist farmers. This model of development not only exacerbated the crisis, leading to an environmental catastrophe. So what is the meaning of exacerbate? It made worse. So this model of development made the crisis for the farmer even worse. So much so that an environmental catastrophe came. Catastrophe meaning a very big situation which damaged the environment also, and also destroyed millions of rural livelihoods. Because now major capitalists are there in the scene. So where will be the place for the poor, simple farmer? Agricultural production in these states remained fluctuating. So sometimes yield was high, sometimes yield was low. The price did not increase despite supply stress. The cost of cultivation kept increasing. The net income flow to the farmer household stagnated. Because the cost of cultivation is increasing and there is hardly any produce for these farmers' households. So they don't have even enough to eat. and sustain their families. So then the farmer took loans to meet the cost of cultivation. As income could not meet the expenditure, he could not repay the loans. Not able to come out of indebtedness, suicides occurred. So this was the gist of how the farmers committed suicides. But a major chunk of this chapter talks only about this, which will take in the next part. Seventh point is peculiar banking practices and non-availability of loans from institutional sources. So there are two types of institutional finances that are available, and they have given the example of Karnataka. For example, there are commercial banks and regional rural banks. So commercial banks, they look for profit, and regional rural banks are basically cooperatives for the people of the bank, those who get together and raise some money for each other. But these regional rural banks are very limited in their capacity because of their inability to repay the loan. So these are the professional banks, and therefore their transactions involve substantial amount of paperwork to obtain credit for the farm sector, which was difficult for the illiterate farmer to submit the duly filled documents. So their the form filling and the procedure is so complicated to apply for these loans that a poor and uneducated farmer cannot avail of these loans. Therefore, naturally, credit from these institutions gets delayed due to the process of documentation. So documentation is about filling up various forms in order to take the credit facility from these banks. And they have a very high rate of interest also, which the farmer obviously is not able to pay back. The cooperative credit structure provides credit with little ease. However, the availability of the credit is limited, as we have already discussed. These cooperative sectors are also there. They will also give institutional credit, but they will not give enough for the farmer to look into the cultivation and other practices. There came NABARD, the National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. It refinances the cooperative banking institutions and therefore imposes certain conditions for delivery and recovery of the credit. So we have read about it in the previous chapter. I think it was chapter number 3, where we talked about these contribution of these banks, that they come to help these cooperative banking institutions, which are from the rural areas only, to help them to raise more money for the farmers. But what is the point of raising more money when they know that the farmers are not in a condition to pay back the loans? So eligibility, most important concept in dictating the performance of this sector based on the repayment performance. So these banks, NABARD, will give refinance only those cooperative banking institutions which are considered to be eligible. And who are eligible? Who have a repayment capacity. Naturally, the primary credit cooperative societies in the underdeveloped regions have lower repayment performance. So these kind of cooperatives who fall in the poorer regions are unable to repay, and that's why they are denied of these kind of refinances by banks like NABARD. I hope you are understanding. They are complicated concepts, but if you read the chapter well, you will understand. So try to understand what are the problems of these farmers from all the sides, that they are not even able to take the loans from institutional sectors. So the farmers have to then depend on the other informal sources of credit. So now they have no other option but to go to the private money lender, who will exploit them to no end and who will give them money at a very high rate of interest and will calculate their interest also falsely in a wrong manner to extricate more and more profit from them. Now the eighth point is the failure of the cooperative sector. So you know how the cooperative sector came into being. It came into being when many village people only got together to look into each other's affair or as any kind of joint collaboration with the help of some institutional support also from outside. So that is from some other banks will also support these kind of cooperatives. They could have helped the farmers in overcoming their debts, but the Karnataka government failed to make the cooperative movement a success. This cooperative movement also failed. For instance, in Karnataka, this some data is given, 32,382 cooperative societies are there at the village level. Almost 40% of them are running heavy losses. So these cooperative societies are there to repay, to help the farmer. But because of their being inefficient, that is, they are not ineligible. They are not able to repay the loan taken by these big banks for the rural farmer. They are in between. They are between the rural farmer and the big banks. So the banks give them credit to be some credit on some criteria, on some conditions to be given to the farmers. But as the farmers are not able to repay the loans, from there these cooperatives will give the money back to these big banks from there they had borrowed. 20% are either defunct, that means they are not at all functional now, they are closed now, or on the verge of bankruptcy. So they are almost becoming, going to become bankrupt. That means no money left with them. Ninth point, dependence on groundwater for irrigation. That is also one of the major problems that these farmers face. Irrigation is another major requirement for agricultural growth. The actual area under canal and tank irrigation has been declining since 1990s. On the other hand, there is a phenomenal increase in the dependency on the groundwater resources through wells and bore wells. So canals and tank irrigation is not helping them much. It is not there. It is rather declining. So they have to depend on the groundwater. And how long can you take water from this earth, Mother Earth? This will also go dry one day. This is what is happening to the groundwater. Now, combined with monsoon failure and decline in surface irrigated area led to drying up of bore wells due to inadequate recharge. So bore wells also take from the monsoon or from the surface, that is groundwater only trickles down and becomes the surface water trickles down and becomes groundwater. So there is hardly any, the area is not getting irrigated only. So where will the bore wells get water? The no water will seep in into the earth to make more groundwater, and there is no monsoon also to provide for the groundwater to increase. Tenth and the last point is rise in drought prone areas. So as a result of all that irrigation problems and decline in groundwater table, there is a rise in drought prone areas. So drought prone areas in India are on rise. So which are the states which are considered to be major drought prone states? These are Rajasthan, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra. So Karnataka is ranked second in the drought incidents, increased from 63% to 72% owing to erratic monsoon and lack of drought proofing methods. So there are two things. They have to depend on the monsoon, but monsoon is very erratic. That means sometimes it will come, sometimes you don't know. You cannot actually predict whether the monsoon will be there and how much will it rain. They can't actually predict. Also, they lack the drought proofing methods. There are certain methods which can prohibit, which can stop the drought to come. But those methods are not there. They are not employed by the state government to protect the farming from this drought situation. A total of 157 taluk and 64 taluks were talukas and 64 taluks were declared drought hit in 2012 and 13 and 13 and 14 respectively according to NABARD. So So these are the 10 points that told you, gave you some idea about the kind of problems the farmers are facing in the area of economic and agricultural problems, other than the social problems. So this ends this part, and we have some questions for you. There are 3 questions. Briefly describe the social problems of Indian villages. So you have to describe those 3 problems which are there, come under social problems. Then briefly explain, you have to explain briefly the agricultural and economic problems of Indian villages. So all these 10 points, you have to just briefly discuss them. And then briefly explain the causes of rural poverty according to the World Bank. Very important question. So please do these questions, and we'll give you the answer in the next part. With this, we end this part, and we thank you. And please read the chapter well to understand it, and try to gauge what all you have understood, because there's a lot of information in this chapter. So you have to be in touch with the details. Don't postpone reading and learning this chapter. With this we end. See you the next time with the next part. Om Sai Ram.